I think we're going to go ahead and get started. I wanted to welcome everybody to today's Wednesday webinar. I'm excited to welcome our partners from Tyson Foods today. We have a great group of people that are going to be on the panel, and I'm really intrigued by the title, Careers at Tyson Food, More Than Meets the Eye. Very clever. I like that. And I think it'll be exciting. I've talked with many of these people before, and they have some great background. And Tyson has a lot of great stuff going on, especially for veterans and so many different positions and different parts of the industry that you wouldn't even expect. And so as a company rooted in its core values, Tyson aspires to be employers of choice for veterans. Today's event will feature a panel of team members who have served in the United States Army, Navy, Air Force, and they are going to discuss some of their soft skills and how they developed, what they developed in the military and how they can translate to successful careers at Tyson, which is a Fortune 100 modern food company. Today, the panel is going to be moderated by Richard Ryan. And before I turn it over to him, I just wanted to give you some personal experience here. I retired from the military after 23 years, and I can tell you that I had a shallow understanding of what some of these big corporations could do and what capabilities and positions they might have. And I would like to think that I've now learned, but when I was transitioning, it was a lot harder to realize and visualize that. And I've had this conversation with many of the people at Tyson, and I didn't realize how many different roles and possibilities there were at these type of companies. So I'm excited to hear more about what type of positions they have available and what it's like to work at Tyson. I can tell you by the banter we've had before we let everybody in that this is a great group of people, and I think I'm pretty excited to hear what they have to say. I do want to remind you that today's webinar is recorded, and if you have any questions, feel free to drop it in the chat, and we'll get to them towards the end of the webinar. So without any further ado, Richard, I'm going to turn it over to you.
Thank you, Richard. I'm going to first start off introducing our panelists. First off is Stuart Glendinning, EVP Chief Financial Officer, U.S. Navy Reserve, 5 years. Second is Scott Spradley, EVP Chief Technology and Automation Officer, father and grandfather were U.S. Marines. Thirdly is Angie Christos, SVP Retail Sales, U.S. Army, 4 years. We have William Nettles, Associate Specialist Talent Acquisition from Tyson Foods, primary veteran recruiter. Next, we have Sean Ryan, Safety Manager, Tyson Foods, Fayetteville, Arkansas, U.S. Army, 26 years. Next, we have Marissa Savelles, Managing Counsel of Disability Law, former ACP protege, U.S. Air Force JAG, 9 years. Brian Tannenhill, Senior Manager, Procurement, U.S. Marine Corps, 10 years. And I'm Richard Ryan, Tyson Transportation Social Media Coordinator, and I'm your moderator. So let's move on with this. Tyson Foods is an enterprise is making investments to become the most sought after workplace. That means we are focused on health, safety, and well-being of our team members. We offer competitive wages and benefits. We are investing in automation and technology in our facilities and how we make decisions. As part of this, we are nearly aware of the benefit and strategic advantage that comes with employing and retaining veterans and military spouses to our team. Let's go to a first question for the panel. As team members at Tyson Foods, what aspect of becoming the most sought after workplace should we highlight for the ACP proteges?
Yeah, I think to go ahead and start, I'd like to maybe send it back over to Stuart. Stuart was going to speak with us a little bit about Tyson Foods holistically, and for everyone on the call to understand a little bit more about who we are as a company.
Great. Well, look, thanks for that. I'm just going to give you the 5-minute version of Tyson Foods. It's an amazing company, a company that comes from a wonderful family history, and a company that's looking ultimately to be able to feed the entire world. And I want to give you a short understanding of Tyson. The thing you should know as prospective, you know, if you're looking for a job, that Tyson has got enormous size and scale. And therefore, think about the U.S. military. And there are many different jobs that any servicemen and women are capable of doing. It takes all of them to sort of to make the complete military. And Tyson's the same. We have a broad range of roles. So believe me, no matter what you're looking for, Tyson has that opportunity. The company was started in 1935 when John Tyson was looking to feed his family. And he started by transporting poultry between Arkansas and Chicago. And that led to the company that we have today. And we're proud of our company. For the sixth straight year in a row, Tyson is the number one most admired company in the food production industry. So we're proud of the kind of company we built and the company that we are continuing to improve. To give you a sense of Tyson, it is a Fortune 100 company. Last year, we did $47 billion of sales. And this year we expect to do around or more than $55 billion in sales. So the company is growing. We have a little fewer than 140,000 team members around the world, most of them being in the United States. If you think about beef, pork, and chicken, which are the primary proteins that we process, we do about 1/5 of the US market. So if you're having a steak or a pork or a piece of chicken, 1 in 5 chance that's a Tyson product. And in addition to that, we have a range of very, very well-known brands. Obviously, everybody knows Tyson, but you'll also know brands like Jimmy Dean, Ballpark, Hillshire, Right Brand, Bacon, some of these brands which are really well-known in the marketplace. But to give you a sense of the scale, we have the ability to process 47 million chickens a week. We have the ability to do 155,000 head of cattle, 469,000 head so this is a company that's got scale. And I tell you that only to let you know that this is a company with opportunity. We have 140 facilities across the country. And that means that no matter where you are in the United States, and no matter the kind of job you're pursuing, it's likely that Tyson has an opportunity for you. We're a staunch supporter of the U.S. military, and we have a range of programs designed to support people who are actively in the military. But even more importantly, we look to make sure that military members who are coming out of the military have a great place to go to work. And I'll finish with the description of Tyson by saying that one of our top goals is for us to become the most sought after place to work. And we do that by looking after each and every one of our team members every single day, by focusing on their health and safety, by focusing on their wage and benefits, and by making sure that their careers are rewarding. And so I hope over the course of the session today, you're going to learn a little bit more about Tyson. And very interested in coming to explore the opportunities we have. So I'll turn it back over to you, Richard.
You're on mute.
I hope I'm not on mute.
Thank you for that.
You were good, Stuart.
All right, let's go on and jump into the question. As team members at Tyson Foods, what aspects of becoming the most sought after workplace to work should we highlight for our ACP proteges?
Absolutely. Well, I'll jump in on that one, Richard. So like Stuart was saying, when it comes to being the most sought after place to work, we want to make sure that we're hitting a handful of different areas that we know are important with our team members in their everyday life. So one of those first is going to be that competitive wage. We want to make sure that, and especially in, all times throughout the country, we want to make sure that our team members are being taken care of and that they can not only support themselves, but support their families and help support their communities. We are always actively engaging in compensation evaluations and making sure that what we're offering and what we're paying our team members is competitive across the market. We also look at, what is maybe more of that non-financial investment we can make in our team members? What are ways that maybe it's not going to reflect on their bank account, but they're looking and they're being developed for long-term success with Tyson Foods or elsewhere. Most recently, when you think about investments, Tyson Foods has announced that all US-based team members are eligible for free continuing education that would cover tuition, fees, and books at participating universities and other programs through Guild Education. We're really excited about it. Recently, all of our team members have been able to start enrolling and looking at different programs to help continue growing their career. We also have different affinity groups here at Tyson Foods that we call business resource groups. And these are groups that are for team members in different areas or who identify in different demographics within the organization, including Veterans Business Resource Group, the Women's Business Resource Group, African Ancestry Alliance Resource Group, which give great opportunities for giving back to the community through Tyson, as well as getting to work closely with like-minded and the same individuals and allies within the company. So really great opportunities to be connected within Tyson and to find that long-term here.
Thank you. Now, can you elaborate on the company's needs regarding technology and data analytics?
I think you're asking me that. Is that right, Ryan?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, I'd say, so it's interesting. When you look at Tyson Foods, you know, the biggest challenge that we have is having enough labor. Stuart very eloquently described the impact that we have on the food supply for the whole nation across all the products that we serve and the different brands and all that. So labor becomes a big issue. The way that we're going about trying to solve that is A, improving safety, but B, bringing in significantly more automation. So I think Richard mentioned the investment in technology and automation. Well, basically analytics are what are going to drive a lot of that. So when we start thinking about trying to improve automation, there's two kinds of automation. There's mechanized automation and then there's robotic automation. Both of those are really trained through the use of advanced analytics. So we've kind of gone from a company that used to talk a lot about things that happened in the past to now we're really talking about things that will happen. So getting to predictive. Predictive delivers all the data. And I know the military is very, very strong in that area. And I've had the pleasure of working with some folks who've come from, you know, places like counterintel, counterinsurgency, and some of those are going to get a lot into the analytics around where things might happen. So we're doing a lot of work so that we can train robots, so that we can train automation to be significantly faster, more agile. But more importantly, we really are always concerned about the safety of our people. So I think, I don't know if Stuart, if you said, I think we're 140,000 people, but it's probably close to about 130,000, 125,000 that are on the front lines. They're working in some tough environments in some cases. The data and analytics are what help us improve safety programs as well as bringing that automation. So a lot of opportunity in that space.
All right, thank you for that. Well, let's talk a little bit about soft skills and interpersonal skills. In the military, your individual, your team, your mission success are dependent on developing and refining those soft skills like teamwork, collaboration, adaptability, and problem solving. Brian, would you want to talk a little bit about how we can share those soft skills will translate to a company like Tyson Food? And then one step further, would these skills give you a competitive advantage at Tyson Foods?
Yeah, absolutely. So I think my personal story kind of lends itself to show that those soft skills are highly in demand and are able to be leveraged in this environment. So believe it or not, when I got out, Tyson didn't have a need for any Osprey pilots. So very, very little demand for that in this industry. But utilizing the skills I developed in the military, precise communication, the ability to perform in high pressure situations, adaptability and flexibility, I was able to become a senior manager in our procurement department, responsible for millions of spend supporting our direct operations. So using those soft skills, being able to problem solve, being able to work within a team, being able to lead a team is what I was able to leverage to start my career in Tyson Foods and to continue to grow in the organization. And I believe it's been a huge advantage. If you can perform in the military in these high stress, interesting environments, then you translate that directly to the Tyson Foods environments and the challenges we face on a day-to-day basis with the supply chain, inflationary pressures, et cetera. You're able to synthesize that problem with imprecise information and then come up with a solution and keep that can-do attitude to keep trying to solve that problem. And it's been greatly able to be leveraged throughout my experience so far at Tyson Foods.
All right, thank you for that. Sean, let me ask you something. What advice would you have for an ACP protege in highlighting these skills during the interview and application process?
Thanks, Richard. Hey, one thing that I know, a trap that I fell into and possibly some others do, is we think that, hey, I'm transitioning out of the military. I'm a veteran. Somebody had to step up and give me a job because I've earned it. And what we want like to remind people is, while companies do give veterans the benefit of the doubt, you know, and extra opportunities to seek employment, we don't, you know, as veterans, shouldn't expect that we're going to get hired just because we are a veteran, because we have a responsibility to our customers as a company, that when our customers win, we win. And so we have to have people that can come in and deliver from day one. The good news about that is, you might not know that yet, but your military experience has set you up to do just that. So just because you're an artilleryman or an Osprey pilot and you don't know how that's going to transition into Tyson Foods, the stuff that you have learned in the military will set you up to do that. The best thing to do is to grab your NCOER or your OER or your fit report or whatever it is you have, and translate that into civilian speak. There's a lot of acronyms and stuff that you understand that other people will not. I recommend that you bounce it off a family member. Go call your mom and say, hey, mom, what does this mean to you? And if she understands what that means, then probably Stuart Glendenning is going to understand what that means. But you know, we want to break down those experiences you have to where a civilian reading your resume will be able to understand what it is you're bringing to the table. And with your resume, and additionally, and more importantly, on your interviews, a technique we like to use is the STAR method, which is situation, task, action, and results. It seems very familiar to task, purpose, method, and effects if you've written any mission statements in the military. So you talk about where you are, or what your situation is, a task that you have done, what action you took, and then what the results were for that action. And you can break down your military experiences into a language that civilians will be able to understand by following that structure, and just making sure you remember that, you know, you may not be able to fly Ospreys at Tyson Foods anymore, but all those things that you developed and built that put you in a situation where you could do that for the Marine Corps, like Brian did, then that's something you can bring to Tyson Foods and add results to the bottom line from day one.
Thank you for that. Let's keep this going. Some of the panel members here have made the transition from military to the corporate setting. Let's talk the most helpful tools and advice or things that you wish you had done or known. Marissa, would you like to share your experience?
Sure, thanks, Richard. I am a former ACP protege, and I found American Corporate Partners to be the most helpful tool during my own transition from active duty to the corporate setting. I don't know about anyone else who's in the transition or thinking about it, but you know, you have to drop your paper 6 months before your last day in status. And you assume that companies are going to want to extend an offer of employment during those 6 months, but actually that's not the case. So I would just encourage everyone who's going through the transition to give yourself grace. It's going to take more time than you think it will. I am very type A, like many other military veterans, and I wanted it to go a lot faster than it did. So I would encourage everyone who's in ACP to use your mentorship. Exactly what Sean said. You know, I didn't send my resume to my mom, but I sure sent it to my ACP mentor, and she was an in-house counsel at a large corporation, and she was very frank with me about what would translate well to potential employers. And it's incredibly important. Take the feedback, change your resume. These are not performance reviews that you have annually in the military. They're really a tool to help explain what skills you have and how those can translate to a corporate job. The other thing I would mention is you need to practice interviewing. This is not natural for military veterans, because you get an assignment and you're on the job, and that is typically your interview unless you're going for a specialized position. So please use your mentor to practice interview questions if you have them. I think one advantage I had as a JAG transitioning into an in-house counsel role is explaining to my potential employers that I, in fact, had the skills already to serve as in-house counsel. So instead of advising a commander about risks and opportunities and providing a recommendation about how to move forward, I'm advising business leaders. So translating that for interviewers to explain, you know, it is mystical, the military, for some civilian hiring managers. So demystify it and explain, you know, you are, you know, the clients here at this company are a lot like the clients that I had in the military. But instead of, you know, the profession of arms, we're selling protein. So your core skills can be reapplied. But bottom line, I'd recommend that everybody give yourself grace. And if there are any legal professionals who are tuning in today or watch this at a later date, please reach out to me on LinkedIn if you're interested in a legal position here at Tyson Foods. As a veteran, I want to pay it forward. And that means making myself available to JAGS or other legal professionals who want to join our team. So thanks, Richard, for the question.
And thank you for that. We have certain career fields at Tyson Foods that may be interesting to those of you, and depending on your experience and career ambitions. Scott, let me ask you this. In your experience, how have veterans enhanced the work experience with the technology group? And take that one step forward, what technical needs do we have that veterans could fill?
Yeah, I kind of go back through my career, and I've been in technology my whole career. I may look like I'm 25, but I'm actually 77 years old. No, I'm just kidding. You know, I would say that cyber, automation, safety, analytics, logistics, procurement, you know, another big area is design of systems and processes is a big thing. And kind of in my experience, I've seen a lot of military people who've had a lot of experience in these areas. They again, going back to counter intel and counterinsurgency guys, they really understand threat. They understand threat analysis. They understand threat prevention, which is a big part of the cybersecurity practice that we have. They have global knowledge on different regimes. They know the differences in attack styles from state-sponsored terrorism to just some nefarious rogue actor, because there's always an attack that seems to be happening on that. And they're kind of hell-bent on disruption. So those folks have really done very, very well in that area. I've seen like logistics, procurement, process design, some of those things. I mean, predicting where you're going to need, whether it's the most obvious things like armaments, but also food and supplies and the infrastructure that you need to build an outpost or to build whatever it may need to be, shipping things all around the world. I think the military has been some of the best that we've brought in, because they really look at, you know, the military has to be where it needs to be when it needs to be. There's not a lot of time for that. So they're always prepared with great processes, with strong playbooks. They know how to do what needs to be done to get where it needs to be, when it needs to be. And so those have all been just serious for, in my experience. And I've had people across all of those dimensions. Probably the most provocative are things around prediction and cyber, and then just truly amazing folks that have worked very hard in some of the process design as we think about worldwide logistics. And you know, Tyson is a massive logistics company in its own right. I mean, we're moving product all over the world, we're moving product all over the United States. Stuart actually has a little map that kind of shows many of our locations. We have about 148 different plants, and it moves from coast to coast. It moves, you know, from the heartland of America all over the place. Getting it there while it's fresh, while it's fast, is a big challenge. And so that's a big area that we can use a lot of help in.
All right, thank you. Now at Tyson, we also have needs in transportation and logistics. William, would you care to talk about that subject?
Absolutely. And, you know, Scott definitely hit on it when it comes to looking at team members for Tyson. We kind of have our two different areas. There's the experience piece, but then there's also kind of that five C's behavioral, you know, how do we look at a Tyson team member and how do they do their work from day to day? And so I think from a recruiting standpoint, when you see a veteran come through, you know that five C's is going to be there. You know that they're going to care about their work. You know that they're going to collaborate with their peers. You know that they're going to come with creative solutions, and they're going to be comfortable with candor, you know, being able to say what they think and what needs to happen in the room. You know, when you hear transportation and logistics, and I'm sure as a transitioning veteran, that's one of those first things that's always kind of thrown your way. But at Tyson, that's not just long haul truck driving, although we do have those opportunities, but we're really looking for that type of person who can help us continue to take our logistics to the next level. We have our own very large private fleet. And when you have a very large private fleet of your own, you have to have the team member capability and the team member know-how to make sure that everything is getting where it needs to go. You know, we're not just shipping plastic toys around the country. This is product that if it's not taken care of correctly, if it's not planned correctly, could go bad and the company could lose money. So we have a lot of different opportunities when it comes to transportation and logistics across the country. These are corporate facing positions that sit here in our Springdale world headquarters, or our Dakota Dunes office or our Chicago office, as well as opportunities at warehousing facilities across the country, distribution centers across the country. Just taking a quick look at the career website, we have over 50 postings right now. That all have to do with that logistics, supply chain, transportation that I think that there are a lot of individuals with a veteran background who could be extremely proficient in those types of opportunities.
Thank you for that, William. Question for you, Brian. How has the transition from military to corporate America worked for you?
So it's been good. It's been exciting. It's a new challenge. A lot like getting a new assignment or being put on a new mission in the military. You come in with very incomplete data, but you have to know that you've had past success and what has worked for you in the past and bet on yourself and kind of move forward in that positive mindset and fashion. So you just take it on as a new challenge. The biggest challenge for me, as far as differences for the military to corporate America, is the language. You're speaking a whole new language when you're talking about business. But then also how you deal with your day to day is more under your control, less regimented, and there's some certain shifts you have to make to accommodate that. So it's been challenging, but in a positive fashion. And there are days where it was a little bit more exciting than necessary, a little bit more stress inducing than you would think it would be because it is so unknown. But one thing you have to do is give yourself grace, like Marissa said. You have to be able to humble yourself a little bit, realize you're not going to have 100% of the answers, and then be willing to ask for help. There's a lot of people out there that want to help you. I've had tons of great relationships in Tyson Foods, just admitting that, hey, I don't know what I've got going on here. Can you help me with this? And people have been more than willing to reach out and support you because they know you have skills to offer. They know you can contribute to the team. You're just admitting that you just need the right guidance to be able to do that. So all in all, very positive experience. And there's plenty of parallels that you'll find between corporate America and the military for sure.
All right. Thank you. Marissa, and I've got a couple of questions for you. How does Tyson compare to the military?
Sure. Thanks, Richard. I think a comparison may be opportunity is everywhere here at Tyson Foods. I came in as a commercial attorney for one of our business units, and I had many different opportunities in the last 4 years that I've been with the company. And I could say all of that is due to a little bit of luck and a lot of hard work. So I'd encourage anyone who transitions into a corporate setting, you know, you have to put in the work. And you have to take advantage of small opportunities that are given to you. One benefit and advantage as veterans when you're coming into a corporate setting is that you're incredibly adaptable. You're put into all kinds of unknowns in the military, and not all civilians who haven't had military experience are comfortable in unknown or uncertain situations. So use that comfort to stretch and grow when opportunities come your way. And don't be afraid. I think a lot of veterans have a quiet confidence, and that is an easing kind of vibe for others. But I'd also like to ask Angie about her own transition. You know, there's a lot of community here at Tyson Foods, and Angie was a champion for the veteran community last fall during our Veterans Day celebration, and we had a spotlight on ACP. So I'd love Angie to share about her own transition from the military.
Yeah, thanks, Marissa. I'd love to. Just sort of as a plug for Tyson, and as I reflect back on my own transition, I really felt a very similar culture here at Tyson as I had found in the military. Some examples of that include, you know, Tyson's a big organization, but we serve each other first and foremost. And Stuart hit on this a little bit in the upfront of his discussion with us. I mean, we just simply recognize that we're better together than we are individually. And that should sound familiar to most of us here on this call when we work together as a team. And then we've got a common interest at Tyson. We all serve our customers and our consumers. And then finally, we just, you know, we win and we lose together. And we strive to just do all that we do every day with such excellence. And so we come together as a team, we work together as a team, we win together as a team. And as pointed out earlier and who Tyson is, I mean, we manufacture and sell protein with a lot of great brands, but it takes so many different functions and specialties to make all that happen that I have just found in my experience here at Tyson that there's a fit for so many individuals. And I love that for as big a company that we are, we seem small because we are wired together, you know, through our common goals. We work together in a family-like sort of network and organization, and we sponsor each other and mentor each other. I have had my transitioned out of the military, some of that mentorship giving back, and then mentors that have helped develop my career over time. So a little bit about my reflection on the transition, and I hope you find that a bit helpful as well. Plus it's a plug for Tyson and the support of our veterans. Thanks, Marissa, for that.
Thank you very much. All right, let's move on to the operational side. Sean, can you tell us a little bit about why the military background is well suited for that? What is it like at the facility?
Yeah, thanks, Richard. And hey, when I think about what we do here at my production facility, I think about it like my unit, and it's very much like a military unit. So let me know if any of this sounds familiar to any of you guys. We require people to be on time with the right equipment needed to work and ready to work and to do that consistently. And anybody that's ever had to stand in a formation, you probably have heard of that kind of stuff before. We ask team members and leaders to learn our processes and then follow the steps that we put forth in what we call standard work instructions. And we have these standard works that we require our supervisors to lead. Sounds very much like an SOP that you would see in the military. Sometimes something goes wrong and we've got to change our process a little bit, and we don't just do that willy-nilly. We want to have a controlled process for doing that. So when we do that, we ask our leaders to analyze what the situation is and what that change is, and then develop a plan in which you can compensate for whatever is occurring at the time. We want that plan communicated so your team members know what they need to do differently in order to continue the processes going. Evaluate that new process and make sure that it's working for us. Change it as necessary if we need to. And that's occurs at my facility every day, probably happening right now as I speak. And that sounds very very similar to troop leading procedures that a lot of us in the Army used to use when we would develop a plan to send to our subordinates. But we ask our supervisors to be accountable and responsible. And all of my supervisors have direct reports, have some equipment they got to keep up with, but nobody does that like the military does. I mean, how many people on this call has been responsible for millions of dollars worth of equipment, dozens of people, and every aspect of their life? I mean, once our team members leave Tyson Foods, they're going home. In the military, you're going home with them. And sometimes you go to their house and help them do all kinds of things. So nobody does that like a military person does. And we need those skills, those team building skills here at my facility to make our team work. I know in the Army, and those of you that aren't in the Army, you probably heard something similar, but one of our Army values was personal courage. At Tyson Foods, and you've seen some in the chat window, some talk of our 5 C's, which is how we behave as a company. Well, one of our C's at Tyson Foods is candor, which I don't think has been mentioned yet, but that's that process where you say the hard thing to say in the room. You don't keep anything to yourself. You say what needs to be said. You listen to what other people are saying, and then you come to an understanding. So that's something that we require leaders in the military to do, and we require people here at Tyson to do the same thing. But the number one thing we do at this facility, and the thing that I'm most proud of as a safety manager, is taking care of our team members. We call that servant leadership in corporate America and at Tyson Foods. And what you guys might have heard is taking care of sailors, airmen, and Marines. And that is the number one mission that you have in the military, is taking care of your people. And I'll tell you, if you do that, you come to Tyson Foods and you can take care of your people, you're going to be successful and you're going to help this company be successful. And so the things that you do right now in your unit are the exact same things we would ask you to do at this unit, which we call our production facility or plant. So that transitions very well. And again, once we translate that onto our resume and into our interviews, the resonance will occur with your hiring manager. And I think you guys will enjoy coming to work at this wonderful company and sharing your experiences. So thank you, Richard.
Thank you for that. That was very informative. All right, Angie, the sales team at Tyson is across the country and interacts with some of the largest retail food services and quick service restaurants in the world. You have many veterans on your team. Why do you think it's a good fit, and what is your team looking for in a candidate?
Oh, yes, Richard, thank you for that question. This is the team, the sales team, they sometimes call us the dark side because we sometimes go a little rogue, but we're in it to win it, first and foremost. So we're always looking for, team members that have the hunger to win, right? The hunger to build relationships with our customers, build relationships internally to help get things done for our customers. Definitely a team player, those who are results oriented. And we are always facing challenges. Our customers across the country, all the retailers and the food service customers that we have, they're always looking to fill and build different solutions that sort of overcome new and existing challenges. So we're always in solution mode. So we love those that are energetic energy makers that just get together and try to find solutions for ourselves and our customers so that we win at the end of the day. And then as Richard mentioned, certainly we have, positions all over the country. We have positions that work from home. We have positions that are out of our corporate offices. So we feel like we're a really good fit for a lot of different individuals with a lot of different backgrounds and experiences. And then Richard, I just would like to just call out, given that I have the mic here for a quick second, our customer partnerships. So we partner with a lot of different customers across the country, both in food service and retail environments, to support our veterans, our customers. Unlike Tyson, they all have veterans that work for them. I have many veterans on my team as we do at Tyson collectively. And so what we do is try to spread our wings together in partnership in different communities across the country. For instance, we just partnered with Publix in the Atlanta market to support some of their veteran programs in those communities. So not only am I really proud of the sales team at Tyson Foods, our veteran support with our customers, but love what we're doing inside of our communities in partnership as well. Thanks, Richard, for the time.
Thank you. All right, let's keep this going. Stuart, when you and your team are looking for candidates, whether it's a corporate role or a facility controller at plants across the country, what ideal core skills could a veteran bring to the table?
Well, first of all, we've got plenty of veterans who are working in finance in the military, but keep in mind that ours in finance is a business of analyzing, and I think there are plenty of people across the U.S. military with analytic skills. These are people who pay attention to detail. These are people who can recognize patterns. These are people who can recognize problems and advance solutions. So, I'd encourage a broad range of people to think about a career in finance. Just because you were operating in one part of the military, there's no block to doing anything differently here. Scott shared with you that we just rolled out a program which is going to provide our team members with free education, college education, that they'll be able to undertake while working here. And I think that's a great opportunity. So I would say, if you're listening to this call and you think, I've always wanted to undertake or to entertain a career in finance, don't be put off by the fact that you think maybe that's not where you've been working. We've got lots of roles that can allow people to sort of work their way up through the system. Now, obviously, if you start with no finance background, you should expect that you're not going to start as the CFO, and not while I'm here anyway, because I plan to keep my job. But I do think that. I do think there's a broad range of opportunities, and I just encourage you to think very, very broadly about how that goes. And maybe since I've got the mic, I do have an opinion, a pretty strong opinion, that there has been a there's been this advancing push across the U.S. that degrees are so important. I am less of the belief that a degree in a specific topic is really important. What is important is how people show up to work, their ability to execute that work, and their desire to really make an impact. And so I'm actually driving a program in finance now, which is going to focus less on having people show the paper that shows what kind of degree they have. And it's going to be more focused on building talent and identifying people who really have the innate capability to succeed here. And I'm going to worry a little less about whether they've got a four-year degree or not. They may require some technical training. That is true everywhere. I mean, it's true certainly in the military as you choose your specialties, but that's training you can get on site, on the ground. And we plan to do that here. So that's my sales pitch for finance, and hopefully it's working.
Well, thank you for that. Before I send it over to Sophia, would anybody like to add anything else?
I'd just say that Tyson Foods is open for business. We're an amazing company. We'd love for people on this call to think about a career here. And you've got a set of panelists here who individually would be pleased to provide some guidance and some assistance if you choose to pursue an opportunity here.
I'd jump in and say, you know, it's interesting. There's a forum that most all of the biggest world leaders and CEOs of the biggest companies in the world, and they gather every year, and it's in Switzerland, and it's a worldwide economic forum. And one of the things that they had a lengthy set of dialogues around this year was around food security. And one of the things that's happening is, you know, the world is growing. Everybody knows that the population is growing. So as the world approaches, you know, 10 billion people, food becomes a major problem. And I really, you know, I left the Silicon Valley. I my whole career was, you know, did a couple of startups. I worked for Intel Corporation. I worked for Chevron. I worked for Hewlett Packard. And I came to Arkansas to join Tyson Foods. And there was a good reason why. The world needs more food, purely and simply. And I can tell you this, we are the leader. And the way I look at this, and I'm very analytical, I don't think that there's anybody in the world that is better positioned to be the protein worldwide. And so we, I think, are a company that offers a great chance for people to come in and grow. I mean, we were talking about the Level Up program, which is basically giving the opportunity for people to come and improve themselves through education. But it's a company that's also, it's a very family-oriented approach. You'll find that people really care for each other, and you'll find that this company cares not just for each other, but for the communities that we're in. And so I think you get a great opportunity to come into a company, grow yourselves, expose yourselves to all kinds of different problems to solve and experiences to gain. And that's what builds your career. And, you know, Brian Tannehill is a great example. I knew Brian after he got out of the military, and he reached out. And one of the things I said to him was, you should really look at Tyson Foods, because the experience that you've had, and Sean mentioned this, you're talking about people who've had millions and millions of dollars of training invested in you to manage very, very complex problems, problems that are media worthy, that are game changing across the planet. And you come out of there, and oftentimes people look at you and say, well, you don't have any corporate experience. That's not us. We're saying we want you to come and talk to us. We're saying that because you've been in those stressful situations, because you've managed very significant challenges, we think that you have exactly the right experience to come and join our family. And this is a very unique place, a very, very unique place. And, you know, the world needs more food, so we have to grow. And we'd love for all of you guys to join us. I posted a link to the technology areas in there, but I can tell you this, you can reach out to me on any of you if you're thinking about wanting to come here, and I'll be happy to talk to you offline. So looking forward to meeting some of you.
All right. If we have time for a question that came across the chat, and this is open up to the panel. Does Tyson offer a skill bridge or work with a specific skill bridge program such as HOH? Anybody?
Yeah, I'll take that one. Skill bridge is something that, from a recruiting and a talent acquisition standpoint, we're looking at very closely, looking at how we can integrate skill bridge into positions we have, or working with similar companies who offer that. So that is something that is definitely in conversation and in works as we continue to look at how do we attract talent and that goal to be the most sought after place to work.
All right, thank you, William. Thank you all of the panel for being here today, and thank you for allowing me to be a part of this. I will now turn this over to Sophia.
Yes, so I think Rich Comets, our Senior Vice President, actually had a couple of questions that he wanted to bring up for the panel, so I'm just going to toss it right over to him.
Thanks, Sophia. First of all, after Scott's little speech there, I think if I didn't have a job, I'd be coming to talk to you, Scott. That was great. No, I'll tell you, for those of you on the call that are looking to transition, the number of things that this company has presented as bonuses and growth opportunities is unlike most companies out there. So I want you to understand that we deal with a lot of different companies, and it sounds like a great place to be. So I want to, you know, really stamp my foot about that, because really you want to look for a place that allows for growth, that invests in you, and that is kind of a family, and similar to the military. So I really appreciate it. It sounded really good. And we have, you can tell by the support of this panel, we have 8 people from Tyson talking to you today. So that's pretty amazing. One of the questions that I saw a little bit earlier that I wanted to kind of adapt a little bit, because I think it's a good question, but could be for a broader audience. And it's about kind of figuring out what level to go in. You know, this is a difficult thing for military people, because obviously our skills don't necessarily translate to a job description that we might find. So does anyone have any advice as to kind of how to determine what level they can go in on? Specifically, Justin mentioned, you know, about management position, you know, with his background, but I would imagine there's plenty of people out there that have that kind of question. So does anybody have any advice on that?
Hey, Richard, I'd like to jump in on that, because I had to do some expectation management on my own when I came in. Sort of like what Brian was saying, I was an artillery officer in the United States Army. There's not a whole lot of artillery work to be done in Tyson Foods. So when I entered,
well, wait a minute,
Scott, yeah, you got some interesting ways
to blow up some old systems for sure.
Yeah. New way to deliver chicken. But anyway, and so I had to do a little expectation management myself as a lieutenant colonel coming in, and my peer group that I entered in with was a bunch of people that are straight out of college, 23, 24, 25 year old folks that I had very little in common with. But that's okay, because from that position, I've been able to move into different, I've been in poultry retail, I've been in IT right when Scott got there. I'm in safety now. There are different things you can go, but get your foot in the door and learn what it is that you can do, because there were two things. A, Tyson had to figure out what I can do. And two, I had to figure out what Tyson had that really resonated with me. I had no idea what I would do coming to work in a chicken company, which is what I thought this was, which is why we say more than meets the eye, because as Stuart mentioned, we're in all protein. And so I had no idea what I could come into and work in. And so it's a good way to get in. So sort of, and then also like Marissa said, you know, expectation management, give yourself a break, but get in and find out what you can do. And then it's on you to sell yourself. And again, you've been perfectly prepared to do just that.
I think that's an interesting point you just made, Sean. I agree with that. You own your own employability. And I think that that's the message I was trying to give, is that when you come into Tyson, then kind of the world is your oyster. You can kind of move around and do lots of different things. One more thing I'll say is, and this is something that I say a lot, people think about Tyson, they think about chicken, and there's a very good reason why. When you go to the store and buy protein, chicken is the only protein that is typically branded, right? So if you buy a steak, you don't typically see a brand on there. It comes in a little tray pack thing with a clear saran wrap and a price label, and the same thing with pork. But we have like 23 different brands, and State Farm, State Fair hot dogs, corn dogs. We've got Ballpark Franks. I mean, we've got, you know, Adele sausage, a lot of different opportunities. But I think Sean's point is a great point. You can come into Tyson Foods and you get to own your own employability. You're not absconded to a single function for your entire life. You can move all around. And the point is just coming in. So great point, Sean.
I think, go ahead, Angie, I see.
That's okay. Go ahead, Marissa.
I would also say one of the most important things about mentorship and having an objective yet informed mentor, like an ACP mentor, is you need to advocate for yourself. So my mentor pushed me to, you know, ask for a certain compensation or expect that or look for a position that had that. And I interviewed with two other very large companies before Tyson. And if I had relied on the advice of my dad, for example, I would have taken the first job because I think he was probably as nervous as I was that I was leaving the safety net of the military to go into corporate America. But my mentor pushed me, said, no, that's not the market, you know, standard for compensation for an attorney with your amount of years. You should look for more. So while you should have your expectations tempered, like Sean said, especially if you're going to a different career field that you don't have maybe as many years of skills in, you do need to temper your expectations, but also don't sell yourself short. This is a process. Your first interview, you may not accept an offer that comes from it, and that's okay. Just get comfortable, you know, considering waiting for the right position.
One thing to just add, Marissa, I think if you're applying to Tyson, and Bill can talk to this, we've got a whole recruiting department. These people see people all day long. And if you're not sure where you're going to slot in or how your skill suits translate, believe me, this is a group of people that can give you a whole bunch of ideas about what that can look like. And I encourage you to lean on them.
Case in point, Stuart, my nephew's just coming out of the military. And of course, he reached out to me to try to translate his experience. And I hooked him in with other mentors, as Marissa advised. And, you know, gave him the courage to own his voice and own his ask of an organization as he was going through the interview process. And then the final component that I felt was super successful for him recently, because this happened within the last year, is tying him into William and our recruiting team to just say, hey, it may not be Tyson, but this is a group that can help you, help yourself, whether at Tyson or somewhere else. So it was very beneficial for him. So when you put all this advice together with some good mentorship and networking, it really does pay off. And I just saw that happen personally with my nephew.
Yeah, thanks, Angie and Stuart. I just wanted to chime in as the recruiting representative. I'm going to make sure I put my email address here in the chat for everyone watching. I'd love to be a resource. And if it's not a specific area, I typically do a lot of recruiting for Scott's area of the company. But if there are other recruiters who I can get you in contact with, I want to make sure that I can be that resource for you. I also just want to say your involvement in ACP not only helps better you, but helps better experiences for veterans present and future. I think of all the mentors that Tyson has paired up with ACP proteges at this time, a lot of them are people leaders. A lot of them hire team members. A lot of them do more mentorship activity within the company from a leadership standpoint. And, you know, this is a learning and building experience for you, but it also helps Tyson individuals learn, oh, this is what this means. And so then they can train their direct reports. So, you know, your involvement with ACP or organizations like ACP help companies like Tyson Foods become a better support for transitioning veterans. So thank you everyone for being a part of that.
Hey, one thing, can the facilitator on this download that chat thread, because there's a lot of information in there, and then share that back out with all the people that attended that call, because some people may not have known or seen some of the data in there. That'd be a good thing to do and kind of distribute that back out to the people that attended.
And add our email addresses. I know, Scott, I think you submitted yours, but I'm certainly happy to
I sure did.
Some questions. So, yeah.
I think we're getting close to time. I wanted to thank everybody again. I'm going to pass it over to Sophia. So Sophia has been nurturing the relationship between Tyson for ACP and has been doing an amazing job. So I just wanted to pass it over to her to close us out.
Yes, so way ahead of you all, chat is already downloaded, so that will be included. But yeah, as we are kind of hitting that 2 p.m. Eastern time mark, if anyone has any additional questions, please throw them in the chat. But if not, then I'll start to close things out a bit. Thank you so much to everyone for joining. Thank you so much to the Tyson team. Oh, actually, Leslie does have one. So. She asked, could you tell us more about remote opportunities, kind of what the environment is at Tyson, hybrid, remote, in-person, things like that?
Yeah, I'll take a swipe at it. I mean, I mentioned it from a sales perspective, but we have, I mean, tons of opportunities for corporate environments where there is a need to be, you know, in the office in a more 8-to-5 sort of realm. Our operational groups, obviously important to be there at the plant producing product, but they are also starting to flex their schedules and flex different times of the day, different days of the week. So important that we're doing some more flexible scheduling in our operational roles. And then, you know, we have corporate roles that are full-time. We have corporate roles that are part-time and that you work from home part of the week, you work in an office part of the week. And then certainly, as I mentioned, we have opportunities where it's completely work from home, but requires some travel. So just make sure that as you look through the roles and the job descriptions, it generally will state if it is a corporate role, if it what the travel requirements are, but you'll find that across this organization, we have a lot of different roles that can fit a lot of different lifestyles.
Thank you, everybody. God bless. Thank you.
Yes, thank you, everyone.
Thank you for your service.
As always, our webinars are recorded and will be posted on our website. We'll be up by Friday morning, so please check that out if you didn't get to join or had to leave early. But thank you so much to everyone watching and everyone who was able to join. Thank you so much to the Tyson team again for joining us. You being such a great partner of ours. You are absolutely a pleasure to work with. As Sean said, happy 4th. Hope everyone has a great weekend, and we will see you soon.